because it just doesn't close tight unless you swim. So.
Who you guys are with? You can't really be in here now.
I thought they opened at 12.
No, not till 5, 6 o'clock.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry,
instead of what click my friend has some qu-
understand where you are at any given point in time, I truly believe that you need to fully realize where you've been. And I think that's really key to everything that we do. Does anybody remember a bad 80s movie called Brainstorm?
Yes.
In this movie, for those who haven't seen it, there's a device with these really cool transducers. It's a helmet, and you put it on, and it records your brain waves, and it manages to interpret them such that once I get them on this Brainstorm tape or whatever, you can wear the helmet and you can feel everything I've felt, everything I've seen. It feels like you're living my experience. And I really wish that technology was true, because right now I would make you all put on the helmets and feel what I've felt over the last 2 years. It's really important. I hope that you feel a piece of my story, because the thing about the tale of Pinball 2000 is that it is about passion. It is about a bunch of guys trying to make something happen in an arena that isn't particularly conducive at this particular point in time. So I'm going to take you through the really good stuff, and then I'm going to take you through the really bad stuff, and then we'll talk about it, and it'll be like therapy. So, now I want to say a word about one of the most powerful cultures in the history of pinball. And you need to understand a little bit about that culture so that you know where this comes from and why it happened. And that culture I'm talking about is the Williams Engineering Department. 1,000 years from now, when an archaeologist digs over at 3401 North California Avenue, besides all the toxic waste from the 1930s transformer production, what they're going to find is they're going to find the clan of pinball. And in this clan, there is all of the things that make up this living, breathing organism made up of all these different guys. I've been really fortunate to have worked in some of the most challenging creative environments in the world, I think. I worked at Marvin Glass & Associates, a premier designer of an inventor of toys, inventing toys, and that was a highly challenging creative environment. You know, in order to sell 3 items a year, I had to invent 52 things, and I had to take those 52 things to prototype and show them to toy companies. That was a challenging creative environment. Williams Electronics Games has, in some ways, raised the bar beyond that. It has been more challenging to work there as a designer, even than it was for me to work at Marvin Glass inventing toys. The reason I went to Williams initially was not what you might think. I did not go there with this dying need to design pinball machines. I went there not necessarily with a love of the game. I went there to challenge myself because I looked at the toys I was designing and I said, you know, I get an LED and a 9-volt and a little Mabuchi motor and I've got to make this thing cost $14.95 at Toys R Us. And then I looked at pinball and, you know, this is the heyday of, you know, like, you know, Pat Waller's putting, you know, $100 mechanisms on a play field. And I'm thinking, that looks pretty fun to me. You know, I mean, I want to spend $4,000 making the coolest, you know, coolest toy I can make. That drove me there, and the personal challenge of trying to find this environment that would challenge me again. You know, every 6 years I get bored and I do something else. I worked at Midway in the early 80s on video games. You know, I did pixel graphics, you know, one pixel at a time. And, you know, I designed these really cool controls and worked on games, and I got bored with that and I moved on. Williams, to me, was this place where, you know, the lore of, you know, Steve Ritchie, you know, guys that could design 15,000 pinball machines for a title and essentially live life completely, you know? I mean, 15,000 machines, no big deal. Do it every time up. This was challenging. I wanted to see if I could swim with the sharks, and that's what drove me there. Now, once I got in there and I started working on pinball, you know, pinball kind of saturated me and became a part of me, I think the way that it is a part of you. And it's something that's taken me by surprise. I really did not expect that. I expected it to be another cool design job, and I thought that I was going to get my jollies by playing with, you know, cool toys and cool tools, and this company was going to, like, you know, make me a star. At Williams Electronics, spiritual leaders walk the halls. We're talking about passionate men with insane visions and bulletproof demeanors that insist that they're right. You have never seen grown men screaming and yelling at the top of their lungs in the hallway, fighting over a multi-ball rule. you would think that we were talking about nuclear proliferation with the amount of passion that goes into the product that we make. The nuance, you know, of the return off the right ball guide, you know, to the right flipper on that loop shot, you know, is it too high on the flipper? These discussions are endless. They consume us. You're talking about the most brutal critics in pinball. They make you guys look easy. And the reason I say that is because the guys inside Williams that design pinball machines not only criticize you, but they know what the answer is to the problem. You guys criticize me, but sometimes you don't know what the answer is. There is such pride in this engineering department that we have never once reverse-engineered the competition's product. We have never brought in a machine to find out what made it tick. And I have to tell you that Ferrari reverse engineers Lamborghini's product. But there is an element of pride that says the competition is down the hall, not down the street. So this is a flavor for this culture, this environment. You know, at night, John Papaduke says that the ghosts of the great designers walk the halls. And when you're in your office at 2 o'clock in the morning, all day long you were sure that ball guide was in the right place. And for some ungodknown reason, you know, at 3 o'clock in the morning you decided to move it a 1/16 of an inch. That's, I think, the inspiration of those guys. I hope. It was this passionate group that was repeatedly challenged to step up and try to fix the business of pinball. Management said, we need to make it profitable. The world has changed. No one wants what you guys are doing. You're boring everybody. Invent something new. We can't make, we just cannot continue to repeat ourselves. We have put umpteen million heads on the play field. We have created layer upon layer of ramps. We have convoluted rule sets. We have video modes. We have all this stuff, and guess what? It's not making a difference. All we're doing is just rehashing ourselves. And management says, this has got to stop. You have got to come up with something, or we're done, because we just can't exist inside of this economic model. Our company's a business. You've heard that in this forum a lot. And that business has to make sense. Make it fun. That was the criteria. And, you know, make it fun, they said, and they will come. I have been doing leisure entertainment product for 20 years now. And I have to tell you, the other day I played Revenge from Mars in sort of a mental preparation for this. And I spent an hour on the game, and I came away thinking, this is fun. This product is fun. It's entertaining me. I drained my third ball, and my bonus got me the extra ball. I was jazzed. I mean, you can't plan on that, but I was jazzed. It was fun. I'm not so sure that it's enough to make it fun anymore. And this is a personal thing, and it's one of those things that's discussed constantly. Because I think I made a fun game, and we haven't set the world on fire. But more about that later. Management's call to action on this was first answered by John Papaduke with his version of Pinball 2000. His version of Pinball 2000 had a 27-inch monitor mounted in the back of the back box where the translight typically is. And I have to tell you that engineering as a whole believed in this and followed this vision for about 6 months. I was somehow troubled. I was very troubled because I was around in the 80s, working at Midway. I saw Caveman, I played Caveman, Baby Pac-Man, Granny and the Gators was gnawing at me. These things were bothering me. The lack of interactivity was making me feel like, you know, we really need to put the video someplace where we can do something with it. But we went in this direction, and I'll tell you, this business of interacting with the ball and the video was troublesome because there wasn't an easy way to do it. There really wasn't an easy way to do it. There was a lot of conversation, but it wasn't, you know, you see the after effect and you think, oh yeah, clever, awesome, obvious. It wasn't that way at that particular moment in time. Neil Nicastro, then chairman of the company, calls a meeting up in engineering. And at this meeting, basically the key elements of game design, the designers and the programmers, maybe a few other people, Larry's running the meeting. He wants to know what's going on with Pinball 2000. I mean, we're spending their money. Every day that goes on is a day that, you know, we're essentially spending their money. During the course of this meeting, Larry reports on progress. You know, yeah, Neil, we're doing this, that, the other thing. Neil says, who here does not believe this is the best direction that we need to be taking? This is the direction that we need to be following. And, you know, three hands went up. And, you know, there was a silence. And, you know, the three hands, Mark Wainaw, Pat Lawler, George Gomez, you know, absolute known troublemakers. So, you know, what's your problem? Well, it's not interactive. You know, it's not, it's just, you know, we're playing up there, we're playing down here, we're playing up there. We're already doing that with the dot matrix. This is not going to set anybody on fire. And, you know, Neil has a way with words. He says, well, boys, this is the direction the company's going in, and basically there are three choices. And those choices are, you jump on the bandwagon and you help these guys out as best you can and follow this vision of the company. You invent something better, or you get the hell out, because it's that simple. There is no room for dissension at this point in time. We have to be together. We have to make this work. At the time, I was dating this woman in Boston, and the day of the meeting, we were going to San Francisco for, you know, one of those girlfriend romantic weekend things. You know, she says, she sets it up, and you just go, yeah, no problem. I'll meet you at the airport, catch a plane. The meeting's at 1 o'clock, I got a 3 o'clock flight out, and I call her and say, you know, I might have to meet you in San Francisco, because this is not looking good. It was a terrible weekend. You know, I carry one of these, you know, and if you ever open up my one of these, it's got all these drawings in it. God forbid, you know, some psychoanalyst would get a hold of my notebook from that weekend, because I was totally distracted and just kind of did this all, and, you know, it, like I said, it wasn't a good weekend. So I come back, and Pat comes to see me, and he says, you know, that meeting was about gauging our commitment to this product, and I don't think he walked away feeling real warm and fuzzy about this. I think, you know, we're in danger. We have lived under this danger for a while now in engineering, but every time it gets really close, it's very scary. You know, they're going to yank the plug. Okay, they're going to yank the plug. We start talking about trying to make this video interactive, and we decide that, you know, we have experience with this mirror technology from the 80s. In the 80s, video games could not afford the massive amounts of memory that you have in video games today. So video games were made up of tiny little things, you know, 32 pixels by 32 pixels big, and they were called sprites or picture blocks, and you could move a lot of them, but you couldn't draw scenery. You couldn't make, you know, I couldn't draw a planet or a city, etc. So what we used to do is we would leave the video move, and then we would take plastic and cardboard and create the scenery and marry the two things with something called a combining mirror. It's a see-through mirror that takes the two objects and reflects them together so that to the eye they appear to be together. This is exactly what that is. Now, I did not invent the combining mirror. Some guy at Disney invented the combining mirror. What I invented is the interaction between this virtual object on the playfield and the pinball. And our Eureka deals with that little bit of technology. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. I've told you about what this is. In the chaos after the meeting, Larry says, well, you know, if you and Pat think you can do something, you should do it, because this doesn't look great, okay? That meeting was a troublesome meeting. It basically splintered engineering. It splintered this group, which is why I wanted to talk to you about the culture of that group. When we came out of that meeting, Dwight Sullivan said to me, you know, you guys don't have a better idea. You're just being assholes, and you just, you know, you're just causing trouble. You know, there's no better idea here. You know, you just shut up and get on the bandwagon. John's mad at me, John Papadou, because, you know, this is his thing. And I basically said it's not good enough. So coming out of that meeting, it wasn't great. So we start talking about doing something, and Pat's going, you know, I got all these shiny new tools set up in my garage. We really ought to do it off-site because, you know, Dwight might come in your room and like, say something about the thing we're building, and then, you know, you're going to feel bad, and it's not going to be cool. So Now, let me talk to you about Eureka. You know, you hear about Eureka. This thing inventors do, you know, when they discover, realize, envision. If you've played Monster Bash, you know that Eureka does not happen when Dr. Frankenstein decides that he's going to animate a guy made from parts from a bunch of other dead guys. That's not when Eureka happens. He envisions, I'm going to animate this guy. I'm going to go to the cemetery. I'm going to send Igor. And he's going to come back with these body parts. I'm going to put them together. I'm going to bring this guy to life. That's not when Eureka happens. Eureka happens when he throws the switch, and the electrodes energize Frankenstein, and the table comes down, and Frankenstein comes to life, at which point, you know, he screams, it's alive. That's his version of Eureka, and that is Eureka. So now I'm going to describe Eureka to you as it happened, what I consider to be the first time in Pinball 2000. The wonderful thing about Pinball 2000 is that Eureka blessed us throughout the process. If it hadn't, if everyone hadn't stepped up and been an inventor at some point in time, you wouldn't be seeing Pinball 2000. Pinball 2000 would not have happened. So it's a Friday night, and it's about 9 o'clock. It's late. During the development of Monster Bash, and engineering is pretty much deserted except for Lyman Sheets, programmer extraordinaire, working away on finishing touches for Monster Bash. And I'm in my office with my foam core, my trusty hot glue gun, and all of the elements, you know, my X-Acto knife and the things that I use to do what I do. And I start building that model that you saw. You know, here's the model. It's quarter scale, 3/16 foam core is precisely 3/4 inch at quarter scale. Piece of plexiglass. If you look in here, if you look closely, you'll find a slide from the movie Johnny Mnemonic. It's kind of what I had laying on my desk. So I made this thing, and I started screwing around with it. You know, if you look at the playfield drawing that I shrunk and printed, it's a Monster Bash. So I take this thing and I put it together, and I take my flashlight, and I go, oh my God, Eureka, this is going to work. So it's 9 o'clock, and the phone rings in Marengo, Illinois. Pat Lawler picks up the phone, and yeah, Pat, this thing's going to work, man. This thing, you know, the video on the play field. Yeah, okay, come on, you're coming over tomorrow, right? Yeah. Pat, click. I go running down the hallway to see Mr. Sheets, and I say, Lyman, look at this, our future. Look at it, check it out. Lyman looks up, and he goes, look at the Borg, will you look at the Borg? Look at the Borg, look at that display. He's working on Monster Bash, and, you know, to Lyman, getting rid of the bog in the dot matrix display is what separates the men from the boys as far as programmers. Okay? So he starts, you know, it's about IRQ, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, Lyman, look, it's our future. You know, look at this display. Nobody wants to listen. Okay. The following day, off to Marengo. Pat lives way, way, way out there. I mean, I don't know what you know about Marengo. I don't know what you know about the local geography, but it's out there. And the only cool thing is I've got this brand new M3, and these roads are deserted. And it became a ritual that the very first time, this thing was about a month old, and I got it up to 130 miles an hour before I ran out of nerves, and then tool into Pat's garage. You know? And this became my adrenaline rush. I'm out of here at the end of every day at Pat's. During this time. It was great fun. Clears the head. So we're in this garage, and in this garage, you know, we're talking about Williams, and we're talking about pinball, and we're cutting wood, and we're putting that thing together, that hollow pin thing. That, we, you know, we took an old bottom, and we, you know, basically started building all this stuff. And what we did is we did monitor weightlifting. There's a 19-inch monitor in there left over from when I used to try to develop 80s video games, and that's the reason there's an Amiga hooked up. In the 80s, there was a period of my life in which I was trying to pitch game ideas, And I was running around to anybody who would listen to me, saying, you know, look, this is a great game idea. And, you know, more often than not, they just kind of blew me off. But I had this trusty Amiga with an old D-Paint program, and I had a bunch of images from games I tried to pitch, that big blue robot that you saw in the videotape. I was trying to fire it up for you today, but the Amiga was as cantankerous today as it was when we were working on it in the garage. So we built that thing, and, I mean, we did monitor weightlifting, you know? Hold the monitor up, Pat, what do you think? You know? Oh, yeah, that's it, sure, you know, okay, quick, get a pencil. You know? That's how that thing came about. I mean, it came about using this, and then, you know, we didn't really make any drawings, we just kind of measured this, and, you know, I'm measuring, and Pat's sawing, you know, table saws cooking, places a mess, there's sawdust all over. Patricia, Pat's wife, is bringing out food, and we did this for about 3 weeks, mostly at nights and weekends, because I was still working on Monster Bash, and Mr. Sheets didn't want... You know, I mean, his vision was, you know, the Pinball 2000. He said, yeah, whatever, dude, that's nonsense. So during that time, you know, he just was engrossed in Monster Bash, as he's wont to do. And so we built this thing. We brought it in, and basically everybody was jazzed. You know, everybody, we brought in this conference room, crowd of people, everybody from engineering, everybody's like, wow, look at that. Ideas about what to do with it start just pouring out. I mean, everybody in the room's got something to say about it. This is the shift in gears that sends us in this direction. John's a little upset. He's got, you know, 6 months in a game. He's got a play field. He's got video. He's got things happening. But eventually, John comes around. And one of the very first things that happens once we get going on this project is that John's team actually brings up the very first true interactive video image on a playfield that reacts to a pinball. Cameron Silver programs this thing that looks like a TIE fighter, because even back then their theme was Star Wars, and it's an old TIE fighter because they haven't gotten any material on the new movie yet. So this TIE fighter hovers around and drops to the center of the playfield and kind of hangs around there, and you hit it with the ball and boom, it explodes, and man, that was another eureka. And we're all walking in there going, wow, look at that, that's cool, it's going to do what we said. So the whole process is full of these things. And these are the things that made it. These are the things that made it all happen. During that time, one of the problems was that when it was determined that Star Wars was so far out, management decided that's too far. You guys have to do something before then. So what they wanted was, they didn't want to change the schedule, even though we essentially had abandoned the platform and picked up a new platform and started in that direction. They did not want to change the schedule. They wanted the old schedule to fit the new design. So John's team gets relegated to second game, and they begin searching for volunteers for a first game. And, you know... Lyman wasn't real happy. When I went in and said, you know, Lyman, we really ought to do this. And he is still up to his ears in Phantom Flip, you know? would not let that die. So we volunteer, and now the fun really starts, because now... it's not about making mock-ups, now we gotta make this thing real. And we do have this list that we talked about. In attempting to address what we thought were problems, the business side of pinball, the functionality, etc., are just as important in some respects as, is it fun? They are equally vital to the process. So we begin this process with, you know, Larry running these weekly meetings in which all of the problems that were currently pending were addressed. You know, what are we going to do about this? The Germans want a handguard that is accessible to the location, but the guy at the location can't have access to the money. All these different problems began, and slowly but surely, ideas emerged from the collective 45, 50 people that we had working on this thing to solve every problem. It was an environment unlike any I've ever worked in, because literally we invented new things every week. Whether they were, you know, the skid rails for the bottom of the play field so that you could get a play field out quickly, the connector bus at the back, the concept of transporting these play fields easily, just a thousand details that if you ever have the opportunity to dive into a PIN 2000 and analyze, you will discover. In the midst of this, management is still very impatient, very, very impatient. Show and tells constantly, disruptive, absolutely harassing show and tells. It's the nature of the beast, you know? And Larry had a really good anti-executive force field, but every once in a while, that sucker would go down. And then, the boys are in shit. So, you know, there's a chapter, when I write the book, on Pinball 2000, you know, which is going to read some, you know, I mean, the title, I can see it, it's going to say, Pinball 2000, the game designer's view, or some such. There's going to be a chapter called Inventor's All. And Inventor's All really talks about those thousands of inventions that happened in the nick of time, miraculously, to make this thing work. I could talk to you for hours about each and every one of those things that happened miraculously, but I can't. So we go to London. We haven't tested games yet. We are so buggy. This thing is unstable at best. But the reception in London, and to the company's credit, they absolutely totally supported us. They threw one hell of a party at the Museum of Natural History, you know, black tie, killer food, you know, pretty girls, you know, the works. And it was great. You know, we're like walking around and we got these games on the floor, and there's, you know, we're up against our sister company has got some heavy hitters, you know, Hydro Thunder, video games of note. And when those people got out of the presentation in which the tapes were shown, each of the theme tapes, this is, you know, it's a normal procedure for us. We show these tapes to our customers, our distributors, and few operators, and then we let them at the games. And when the doors opened to this room that the pinballs were in, there was a couple of islands of revenges, back to back in a circle. They were mobbed, and you know, there's photographs and videotape of this. And it was an amazing thing, you know? It was an amazing thing, this hunger for a product that did something, and at that particular point in time, that was the product. London came and went, games went on test. The coolest thing about the internet this time around was I really enjoyed all of the messages that people sent in. It was really exciting to go to work every day, 15, 20 messages. You know, this is so cool, I can't believe this, my favorite of all time. Someday I'll have the Pinball 2000 thing framed, and you know, right underneath it's gonna say, the guy who sent me the message, and maybe he's in this room, all it said was, you've blown my fucking mind. Whoever you are, you've made my day. Little sentence. I had to deal with the guys who were criticizing it and hadn't seen it yet, too. You know, that never ceases to amaze me. And I was telling Larry, I said, geez, you know, this website thing was a big mistake. You know, I got all these guys going to the website, and all of a sudden I got a critique like the guy played it for an hour and he hasn't seen it yet. So anyway, I just want to talk briefly about, production. Production was again one of those problematic things that, you know, startup. And if you got one of the early games, you know, you probably didn't get a perfect game. You have to understand that one of the challenges of doing this game was that everything was going on concurrently, and typically that's not the case. What I mean by that is, you've got an operating system that the game runs on being written at the same time that the game is being written. And you've got a cabinet, mechanical platform, going together at the same time that I'm designing playfields. We don't know, you know, yesterday the playfield was 46 inches long, today the playfield's 43 inches long. You know, the cabinet's doing this, and I have to say I drove some of those things, and we'll talk about why. But all of these things are happening concurrently. We have new artists. We've never designed a video game in pinball, and we have new artists with new tools, and these guys are teaching themselves 3D video art overnight. I had this guy built because Marty the Martian, because it was going to take the video boys a month to draw this, and so what I did is I hired, you know, one of our trusty sculptors, and I told him, I said, I'm going to make Marty the Martian. I want him to be like this, and he goes, what are you going to do with it? I said, oh, you know, I'm making a trophy, because I mean, I didn't want him to know what we were doing. We took this guy, and you know, he's an outside vendor, by the way. So we took this guy and we scanned him. We sent him to a house that digitizes three-dimensional objects. We scanned him and we brought him back into Lightwave, the program that we use to draw our video art now, and then we worked from there. Now today, we can draw this. We can draw this in probably a day and a half. We can draw this color, texture, the whole shebang. It takes us another week to animate him, but we can do this. We couldn't at the time, so we were moving. Everything is going on. If you come up and you get a chance to look at some of the drawings, you'll notice that the tops of the back boxes are called test fixture number one and test fixture number two. In an effort to maintain security about what we were doing, because we were so excited about it, we used two cabinet vendors. We sent the tops to one guy, and we called them test fixtures. We sent the bottoms to the other guy. Now, the guy looks at the bottom. He knows what that is, right? He said, it looks like a pinball machine. It might be 3 inches shorter, but it looks like a pinball machine. But you never know what test fixture number one is. So, if you talk to the Jedi, if you talk to the guys that worked on Star Wars, they have a story like mine about their product. And the story I've told you doesn't include every little nuance. And it doesn't include every little nuance because I want you to buy my book. But you want a happy ending, don't you? You want a happy ending. You know, our heroes struggling to overcome incredible odds succeed. I get the girl. Right off into the sunset. I designed PIN 2000 with all my heart and all my skill. But these are dark times for us. Remember, these are my opinions. This is not an official statement from anyone at WMS. These are my opinions. My spider sense is tingling. My spider sense has been on fire for the last month. Pinball will survive. I'm here to tell you that. I fear that our company may have lost the ability to make it make economic sense. And if that's the case, being that it's a business, they might choose not to be in the pinball business anymore. The engineering department that I so lovingly spoke of is in danger. And the brands that we recognize are in danger. And Gary Stern might just be the last man standing. Please remember that that I tried to elevate the art. Williams has been very good to me. The flood of memories is indeed a brainstorm. If Black Friday comes, my brothers and I in pinball will live to fight another day. I have one more tape, and then we will do questions.
can't help myself.
Can.
Somebody get the lights.
Got to push play.
To see what we can do with Pinball 2000, and to me that's what's sad. If Pinball 2000 goes away and doesn't make it, we think of the first Dot Matrix game that you saw, and think of the things that we didn't do in that first game. You know, I wasn't even around for that, but I mean the things that they didn't do, and then think of what a Dot Matrix game is like, was like at the state of the art, you know, Monster Bash. In terms of that tech, you know, that particular genre. So I guess what I'm telling you is you've seen two games that were built under duress. I mean, they were built in a very short period of time under a lot of stress to get something done and get it kind of working and let's go. I've seen Pat's game. Pat's game is number three. Pat Lawler and Louis Koziarz have a game going that really departs from what John did, it departs from what I did. The video's in the same place, but they've chosen to, I mean, their targets are essentially look like video targets that are absolutely integrated into the three-dimensional architecture of the playfield. So something sitting there looks like it's, you know, it's, I mean, they've worked the ramp into it, everything, it's a different approach. And that is the approach that, you know, it's that Pat and I talked about a long time ago, and he's doing it. There's a lot more, he's had a lot more time to pay attention to lighting. The things that you've complained about in the first two games are things that I think can be improved substantially. We don't think of it as limitation. If all you've seen out of the first two games, you're gonna feel that way. There's no doubt about it. I guess forgive us. We didn't get it perfect.
I'm just worried.
I just like to add something to what George said. If you look at the accomplishment, you're looking at an endeavor that was accomplished in the same time frame that we used to design conventional pinball. Conventional pinball, every designer has a history of games before him that he can draw off of. This is totally fresh. What was accomplished by this first team is just something that's remarkable. It should be obvious to everybody in this room that the content is just so much more. The amount of creative juices is just so much more of what went into any game prior to that. And yet the amount of time that was allowed was the same. So the accomplishment for that team was just unbelievable.
Sir, after RFM came out, there was reports on the internet about how the pinball division finally turned a profit for the first time in a long time.
We did.
Can you comment on the management's opinion of the potential that would seem to bring?
I think it's public, so I probably can tell you. We made $1 million the quarter that we sold RFM, and if you make $1 million every quarter with pinball, I think we'd be in the game. I think that some of it has to do with the fact that our inconsistency, if you will, affects us, and also the amount of money that it takes to develop a pinball machine as opposed to all of the other things that you could do with the money, given the return. I mean, that's as much of an answer as I can give you. Don't get me wrong. Williams has been a wonderful, tremendous place, and this company has allowed me to walk in with a harebrained scheme like this, and turn it into a product. So, don't for one minute. It's a business, and they have to make business decisions. And I'm a designer, and I have to design stuff. And, maybe it's pinball. It's been toys, it's been pinball, it's been video games, it's been whatever. But we do what we gotta do,
Now, what about Star Wars? Does that look like it's making a profit? Or
I think it's doing fine. I think that, I think the amount of steam that we've gotten from the movie's been a little disappointing, but.
Before Revenge from Mars came out, there was a lot of speculations on arguably how the first Pinball 2000 would look like. Do you and your team read this, and do you get influenced by these messages?
Well, actually, I guess you could say that. We do read it, and it really amused us.
A lot of us were surprised at the decision to not include the replay feature. Were there any meetings over that one?
Oh, yeah. Here's the deal. I'm here to tell you that my opinion today is that we made a mistake on replay, and we made a mistake on bossing. I'm telling you that right now. That's my opinion. At the time, I didn't have a strong enough opinion, and some of us did. It's an opportune time to change the play mechanic when you're introducing a new platform. So if you're ever going to screw around with that kind of stuff, that's the time to do it. I was a little surprised at the backlash. We were trying to balance, you've got this new thing, and it's very compelling. It's cool in itself. And we're trying to balance that against, we need to make it make money. And so maybe it's cool enough that this, if you take this away, it's not going to make a difference. There's a lot of, the replay thing has been talked about for so many years. I know Roger's opinion very well. You can talk to Roger and he'll tell you, look, you know, look at Steve Epstein's operation in New York, you know, operated for years without replay, successfully, best location in the country, no replay. You know, I know Larry felt very strong about the replay situation. He drove that. And, I mean, it's something that, like all of pinball, it's discussed and discussed and discussed, and sometimes we take a shot, you know? And we got to do that. We have to try stuff.
So what's your feeling now?
Well, my personal feeling is you got to have it in. I got such a backlash on it that I would say, and I did it twice. You know, I tried it on NBA Fast Break. And, you know, quickly had to backpedal.
You have here what's obviously a great vision, which I hope is the first of many. But when you were putting the first Pin 2000 together, what were you most proud of and what are you most disappointed in?
Well, I'm incredibly proud of the effort of Pin 2000, the thing that Pin 2000, my disappointment is, I fear for it. You know, I don't know what kind of life it has, and I fear that these ideas that all of us have about cool things that we could do with it next won't see the light of day. That's a disappointment to me, and that's a disappointment that may not bear fruit. You know, it's not my best game. You know, my personal feeling is that the best two games I've ever done were Monster Bash and Corvette. Those are my favorites. Those are, you know, they were. Doing a game, you know, is if you're illuminated at that particular point in time about that game, and you totally live it and feel it, the game will be a lot better. And it's not that I didn't do that with this game, but the reality of it is that the platform consumed some part of my creative energy. I proudly tell you that my fingerprint is on every piece of a Pinball 2000. There isn't a box, screw, bracket thing that I didn't influence in one way or another. And I'm proud of that. I'm very, very proud of that. What am I disappointed in? I'm disappointed as hell that the programmers never got those damn boxes out of my face when I do something. these are things that would be polished away on future Pinball 2000s. There's no reason I need to step on the image of Abraham Lincoln, the Robo-Lincoln figure, with a box telling me the score. Absolutely no reason. And that's a polish thing. Just like we spent hours and hours and hours choreographing a dot matrix display and a light show, eventually we will get to the polish level in a Pinball 2000. And there won't be a goofy score box in my face stepping on the graphic that I spent, you know, that the artist spent hours and hours making. So yeah, I have disappointments. Revenge from Mars was picked because it was really important that we did not need to pursue blind alleys as far as a theme. I don't know if I covered that on my, and we wanted to go into the street with a theme that operators and players had a warm fuzzy about. And we didn't have time, you know? I mean, if I show up tomorrow and I say, let's make a hot rod game, I gotta spend time figuring out what that is. You know, I mean, I paint in broad strokes and then refine it. And I didn't have time to do that. So, you know, let's do a sequel. A sequel to something tight and strong, AFM. And that's what we did. Yeah, just because it's something that's talked about all the time. In an attempt to make the game make sense, the business side is important. And every dollar means something. And we have, somewhere in here, there's a drawing, and I brought it specifically for that reason, of the nested cabinet panels. You know, you got a 4x8 sheet of plywood, and if I can get all four sides of the game, top and bottom, out of that sheet of plywood, I save a substantial amount of money. So we did that. In order to do that, and the problem with that is that in doing so, the only way I could make all that stuff fit was to go to a 43-inch play field. And it didn't scare me because I remember High Speed and Black Knight, and I said, well, they're 42, you know? Yeah, we're used to these 46-inchers, and they're nice, but so I'm going to go 43. It's the most I can stuff in the thing. and still try to make the cabinet make sense monetarily. We fought the cost thing every inch of the way. And I'm not real sure that, you know, I mean, I promise you that given more time, it would cost even less. But, you know, you do what you can inside of what you have. Yeah, I think in one of these, when you sit down to brainstorm, you brainstorm and you think of all these cool things that you could do. And what if I didn't have to unscrew the legs? What if I just, you know, flip the lever and snap the leg up and, you know, the leg protects the bottom of the cabinet and et cetera. So, yeah, I mean, I wish I could show you the list. There's some cool stuff in there that, you know, maybe 10 years from now we're still making them. We could do that.
One of the selling points of the Pinball 2000 is the futures are going to be kittable.
Yeah.
Is that going to happen still?
Listen, I don't know if we're going to happen still. I mean, yeah, I would say it's in the it's in the works. There's 500, I think, Star Wars kits or something being sent to Germany as we speak. So.
We've got a Mar Enhanced Fam and get about $300 or $400 a week out of a bench from Mars.
Really?
Because we basically have a culture of pinball eggs and we bring new people into the fold just by being around it so much. But I don't feel a sense of sort of pop culture, fashion, like that leap forward where non-pinball players are talking about it or you're seeing movies or choice movie stars have taken it in their cause. Is there some sort of fashion or, you know, pop culture side of it to take it to that next level?
Well, obviously, one of the reasons to, you know, one of the reasons to do Pinball 2000 the way that we did it was to try to attract a new player. You know, I'm not sure that we've done that yet. And I do believe that I don't want something that burns bright and hot, you know, and burns out. I don't think it's unnatural for a product to take some time to take. And, you know, I have nothing, you know, I have nothing against mechanical action pinball, as my brothers, you know, across town have labeled what we used to do. I was a big proponent of we need a high price line and we need a low price line. I don't want to leave any money on the table. I want to compete in that business too, but that's not my choice to make, you know. So I think that if it takes, it's not going to be because I ran ads. Maybe $10 million worth of advertising would help me, but I think that it has to happen because people are really standing in front of it, having fun and liking it. And if you've been to the arcades, the problem that we face is a universal coin-op problem. It's not just a pinball problem. Our brothers across the street at Midway, their arcade stuff isn't doing any better than our arcade stuff. They have this wonderful cushion called Sega and Nintendo. You know, they sell their product. They make way more money selling a CD-ROM with Hydro Thunder on it than they do making a $4,000 standalone Hydro Thunder. They make way more money. I wish we had that. If we had something like that, then right now wouldn't be as. But the entire coin-operated game business is hurting. It's so hurting. I tell people, look, go to the arcades. Stand there. Who's in there? I mean, Gala is a ghost town. I mean, it's unbelievable. I fear for the business.
George, related to that, were there any discussions of perhaps changing or trying to influence the marketing model from more of a push to the operators as opposed to a pull from your end users?
Yeah, it's talked on. It's all of these things are talked about. And there's problems with that too.
I'm talking as an ignorant consumer. I don't know how to fix games, if you make it work, how push the button is probably the wrong time. But I know personally, and even with my kids, I'll drop $10 into a quarter machine, but I'll think twice about plugging four quarters into one machine.
Right.
And that's just a mental thing for me that I need to be educated on.
Yeah, and you're not the only one that needs to be re-educated on that. And we've tried many, many times. I really feel that every other form of entertainment doesn't cost what it did 20 years ago. I'm not certain why it is that ours has to. And perhaps it's a cultural thing that I can't change, but I mean, a movie doesn't cost what it used to. The popcorn doesn't, the pop doesn't, and the comic books don't. I mean, you know, here's your entertainment dollar. What are you doing? You're 15 years old, you're at the mall, and you're spending around. Well, gee, you know, why is the pinball machine still going to cost 50 cents? I'm giving you a lot more for your money. That would help.
This morning we heard from your competitor, and they seem to have a real good licensing program, especially the secondary licensing to Harley Davidson. I haven't seen that as much with Star Wars. Do you think you have a really good licensing program there with, you know, movie theaters and the studio?
Yeah. We have, from time to time, pursued those avenues. And, you know, Roger's here, and he'll tell you that
everything petered out. Dealers didn't step up. We went back in, and I'm not trying to call sales out of school and arm by trying to comment on whether we had less success than potentially third pinball will now have as a successful venture. But we actually went back in and did a separate run specifically for Harley. Wrote us a check, but these are a number of games. I have to tell you that it was 10% of what they originally talked about doing. And it was a tough battle internally to go back to the three-figure number as compared to the four-figure number that we had anticipated with all of their dealers. And there were thousands literally around the world who were all going to step up and all the fan base. Now, conversely, since you didn't do a major run on that, from what I understand, I guess again, from what we see in the trades, I guess some of the commentary that the competition has been saying is that see if you can find the original Valley Harley Davidson for the same price, and it's like double or triple the price point. I guess his expectation is there's great resale value. That's probably an obstacle. At the time, nobody was willing to stand up when it needed to be stood up for. It's only after the fact, 6 months, a year, 2 years later, it's already too late. I wish them well. I hope they can do it. George commented and tried it. And I'll tell you right now, in FAO Schwartz's catalog, you can buy Star Wars pinball for about triple what it'll cost you buying out of the floor here. But they are already taking orders.
Well, and that's, again, that's part of the marketing model problem, because if you look back at Corvette or Harley-Davidson, you're having Corvette or Harley-Davidson dealers that know nothing about pinball trying to sell pinball. You have normal coin-op distributors that in most cases don't want to deal with, quote, the home market or the collector market, okay? There's not a good retail push. I mean, FAO Schwartz, okay, fine. Yeah, there are going to be a lot of people that will spend $6,000 for a pinball. But if you can find a better way to sell them for $4,000, $5,000, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nothing we build is consumer product, okay? The people who are, for example, in this room, who buy a pinball machine and take it home are way out of the ordinary. Way out of the ordinary. We build games that sit in bars and taverns, bowling alleys, okay? It's an industrial product. It's never meant to be a home product. It's never polished enough from a consumer standpoint who doesn't have enough knowledge to deal with it to make it a home product. The economic model of what we do is based on we're a manufacturer, we're General Motors, and we sell to distribution, which our General Motors dealers, you know, our distributors, okay, who then take that product and move it through the system. And the reason for that is very simple. Okay, it's a very simple reason. As a manufacturer, we need to know that we're good to go to order 2,000 sets of parts before we start building something. Okay? And we need to know that we've got people all around the world that are going to take that economic burden off of us. That's our distribution. They're the people who step up and say, I'll take 20, I'll take 30, I'll take 40, okay? And it spreads out the risk. If we took all the risk upon ourselves to take those gains, okay, and say we're going to sell them straight to the operator or straight to the end user, for example, okay, we economically could not do that. If you multiply the amount of parts it takes, we have a 5-week lead time. George will tell you better than anybody on a game. It's 5 to 6 week lead time to get parts.
And it costs a lot of money to set up an assembly line with tooling and parts to build these things. We can't, you know, we can't overnight decide that tomorrow we're building something else, you know? So, somebody, am I supposed to be out of here now? Somebody who's a drop.
Basically, there's nothing till the auction at 7 o'clock.
Last call for alcohol. Are we done?
It's up to you.
It's up to you.
This is open. There's nothing else out
here. Sir.
A couple other design questions. I know I've read a little bit about the way the speakers are placed and wanted to know more of the history of that. By the way, I like it.
Yeah, we have Buff. I gave him the supersonic hardware credit when I wrote the credits. Andy Eloff is an electrical engineer with a lot of experience designing sound stuff, speakers, amplifiers, etc. And we worked with the speaker manufacturer to develop precisely the volume behind the speaker and the position of the speaker, and of course the hardware that drives it. So all of that stuff was not, it wasn't a, you know, put it where you can fit it kind of thing. And that's, I mean, that's why they are where they are.
I'm sure some of your competitors probably buy your products and then reverse engineering, take some of the good ideas and incorporate it into their machines. Why wouldn't you want to do some of the same if somebody, you know, if a user likes a certain feature of somebody else's machine?
Right. Right. I guess maybe we're too proud. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe it doesn't mean that we don't play their games. It just means that, you know, we have a certain standard, and we try to design to it.
Could you explain the three playing fields? I've never seen them.
Yeah.
So I'm interested.
Yeah, these are obviously whitewoods. They're all Martian whitewoods. This particular guy is the old size. You can see that. And so this is my first, you know, my first whitewood before we ran into the cabinet cost too much problem. Yeah, they're a little heavy. So you can, they'll be around all weekend and you can check them out. Off note, you'll notice an elevator that we didn't end up using, a ball elevator. And I can't tell you what I was going to do with the ball elevator because that will trigger the Ninja Strike Team. you will notice the elevator. I went over here next. This is the first of the short whitewoods. And you'll notice some differences, you know, the wire ramps, which I really like a lot, and of course cost too much. And so you'll also notice the little catcher. You know, the catcher grew to humongous proportions because it never failed. You know, I percentage the white wood, I get every shot in the thing. And as soon as it gets into the programmer's office, guys start complaining that the ball's bouncing out. So, you know, the catcher on the final game is what it had to be in order to satisfy everybody. You'll also notice a few other things here, like I delivered the ball to the front instead of to the back. You'll notice that off the catcher, I didn't go into the jets like I do in the final game. I go into the ramp. And I believe Keith Johnson suggested, you know, why don't you throw in the jets? It's still a nice feed, and we have a little bit more action. And we were looking for a reason to do something more with the jets. So you'll see that. Then we come over here, and this is a lot closer to the final deal. The other thing you'll notice in the Whitewoods is right about now, we're tightening up the rule set, and so the insert layout reflects the final one a little bit more. In these particular ones, I was just placing inserts, not knowing exactly where we were going, which is always, there's nothing fancy about that, that's just the way it always happens. In the beginning, you just throw a bunch of lights in the thing, and then you start writing down rules as you go.
A little bit different thing. There's a reference on the playbill that thanks to Cactus Canyon. Can you tell us what you're involved with that?
The designer of Cactus Canyon, Tom Coppera, is a very close friend of mine, and he was my project engineer on three of my games. He was my project engineer on Corvette, Johnny Mnemonic, and Fast Break. And after Fast Break, Tom one day sheepishly came to see me and said, you know, I want your job. And at that point, there's two answers. And one answer, one thing that you can do is you can say, no, you're not smart enough, you'll never be able to do this. And the other answer is, sounds good to me, how can I help? So that's all I did. I said, sounds good to me, how can I help? And let him do what he does.
Is Pop Duke still pissed off?
No. Pissed off is pissed off, it happens when you work as closely and you're as passionate about what you do as we are. It happens all the time. We coexist and we're fine, and John and I are friends. And I think at some point in time, John had the strength and the vision to pick up the gauntlet when somebody threw it down, and he went,
John probably the person to tell you that he was a leader in preparation for the show. John heard his dad. John probably won't be here. He was in the hospital 2 nights ago when he got out, so you don't know if he can make it or not.
Yes.
It sounds like you're disappointed about a lot of the scores and stuff in your graphics. Would you maybe like to have like a dot matrix display or something that would hold the constant scores separate? Or?
I think there's an elegant way to display information inside the platform. And in some ways, we discovered it late, didn't have a chance to implement it. And in other ways, even what we discovered will evolve. So, no, I don't want another display. The magic of the combining mirror is that I've got you looking where I want you looking. You've all noticed, you've all played it, and you know that the first time you went up to it, you were still confused as hell, and you don't know where the ball went and everything else, and you got used to it. And as the games get better, and the virtual target gets used more as a virtual target as opposed to a movie screen, I think that you'll find that it feels very natural. It feels very natural to us. Very first time I saw a new Corvette, the proportions looked hideous to me. And it took some getting used to it. Now I think, wow, look at that, that's pretty cool. I think that the guys that worked on the new Corvette have been living with that shape for a long time. And you can make the analogy that we're more used to this than you are at this point. And you will become more used to it.
You think it'll reach a point where you have more continuity in the play, where there's no stop and start of the ball play as much?
I am absolutely convinced. And I'm not telling you that pinball as we knew it will cease to exist. I'm not telling you that at all. I'm telling you that both games can and will coexist. And that 2000s, if the company has you know, I mean, if a miracle happens and we continue to, you know, grow and make money, et cetera, they'll be back in it in a minute and a half, and I think that you will see 2000 reach the same sort of level of polish that our old product did.
Two questions, actually. Did the moving around of the dot matrix and Circus Voltaire, either success or whatever, that influence your thinking more? And also, Cactus Canyon, it kind of came as a surprise to me. I hadn't seen it at the show. I hadn't seen it anywhere at home. How did that fit in, since you were already working on Pinball 2000 when it was going on?
Well, I mean, Cactus was, you know, we had certain games in the pipeline, and we needed games to get, you know, to the, you know, to keep the line running. You know, we have this, our factory is this huge animal that needs to be fed some number of games every day. And if it shuts down, we start losing money. We start bleeding. So Cactus was in the works, and basically, you know, here's a product, you've got it all developed, you can go to the production, you know, on such and such a date, you're not going to stop it, you know. It bought us some time, and we needed as much time as we could to get that done. What was your first question?
About the display.
Oh, the display, the Circus display. I think the Circus display was an attempt to get you looking in the play field and not doing this, you know. And I would say at that particular moment in time, no, it didn't influence us. I didn't play a lot of Circus Voltaire, and you know, it just, I don't know, maybe subconsciously I made the connection. I don't know.
How big of a role did Brian Eddy have in developing this?
Primarily, he participated in almost every rule meeting. And Brian's role was essentially a huge contribution to rules and continuity. You know, if you make a movie and you define the characters in the movie, no one knows those characters better than you do. And so there were things that related to the world of the Martians that were best determined by Brian, because he created that world originally. And so my situation when we first took off on this project, and it was a touchy one, but Brian and I are friends, and we talked about it, and I said, listen, I'm going to put my ego aside here because we've got to get this thing done. And we think that this is a valid theme, and we would love for you to contribute, but I'm the game designer, so, you know, I get veto power. But come on board, and if you can work with those rules, and he did, and we did, and, you know, we had a few arguments about, I'm trying to think, I wanted weapons, he didn't want weapons, you know. The Martians, the definition of everything Martian, you know, was consulted and driven by Brian.
When you look at Midway's latest game, NFL Blitz, they made a good effort to relate the home gaming systems with the arcade games, where you could actually, I don't know, make your plays at home on your Nintendo 64 or something, and then bring that to the arcade.
Yeah, by the way, that idea was a tremendous failure. it sounds cool, doesn't it? but Lewis.
What you're seeing outside with the Pinball 2000 tournament system with Tom and Miley floating way behind those laptops, it's kind of a test bed for some technology that we're working on to some degree. And like George says, we're around, we see some of this stuff in the future. We have some good ideas for it. We just need to kind of develop it. Thankfully, Xbox is going to be a great time to actually test some of this stuff out software-wise. But you know, you can't really see what we're working on, but some stuff is coming.
Oh, you could say, but those ninjas.
Well, since I can't find Rob or Mike, I'll come up and do this. Thank you, George. That was great.
over the weekend, take a look at the White Woods, take a look at the drawings, you know, the hollow pin, et cetera.
And it is.
Fireside Chat was a tradition we started a couple of years ago, and it'll give you a chance to get some special moments with these gentlemen and in a relaxed atmosphere, and maybe they'll share you some stories they wouldn't normally share. But it's a lot of fun, and let me tell you who we got here today. We have here to my extreme left, Michael Goblin, and son of Alvin. We're glad he came in from California for the special occasion. Next to him is the living legend himself, who came to the expo in 85, and the story goes like this. In 1984, when I decided to do the expo, I got Elvin's name from Don Murphy. And just the thought of calling a Gottlieb, it's just like, you know, just like dialing the number even. So finally I said, sir, my name is Rob Burke. I have this great idea about doing a pinball show. It's for collectors and hobbies. Would you be our guest speaker at the banquet? And it was take it back. Well, who's going to be there? I never heard of you guys. What's it all about? And I said, well, it's just a bunch of enthusiasts, and you know, we love your games, and it'd be an honor to have you. So it just so happened I was in Chicago a few weeks later for a business trip. He says, come to my home. And I went to his home, and he was dressed very casually, and he said, come on in. And we talked a little bit, and he says, yes, I'd be glad to. So that, to me, that was a big part of the show, and I figured from that point on, the show couldn't fail. And our first year, I remember for the banquet, for those that were there, it was just a tremendous turnout. I'll never forget about it. He gave a synopsis of the history of D. Gottlieb. It was a wonderful film presentation. But anyways, he's very dear in my heart, and I've had the pleasure of knowing him for 15 plus years, so I'm glad he's here. Next to Alvin is Wayne Nyans. And for those of you that have been to the registration table, he's one of the godfathers of design. This young man's built some very classic wood rails from the 50s, and it's just wonderful to have him be a part of our group because his games have meant so much to all of us here who either play or collect the games of the 50s or the famous wedge heads of the 60s. This is the guy behind it. You can clap if you want. Again, I often relate back to the 1985 Expo. Again, for those that didn't hear me during the bumper blast, the reason I did the Expo was for me to honor my heroes, the designers. And at the banquet, we honored four gentlemen, and that was Norm Clark, who was with Williams, and he will be at the autograph session, by the way. But Norm Clark, Wayne Nyans, Steve Kordick, and Harvey Heiss. And those four gentlemen combined have designed over 600 games we've kind of put a number at. So it was just a wonderful experience at that banquet, at that first expo, just to give these guys the recognition they finally, well, they've deserved for years, but they finally got their recognition, and just everyone was just clapping, and as like Dick Pushel said, it was a love-in, because they ever got a chance to finally meet everybody, hear these names for years, Russ Jensen and Steve Kordick, and Steve Young, and we all met for the first time when I won the room, but it was really wonderful, and these guys are part of it. And the last fellow that showed up here today for our fireside chat is a fellow I met via email, but I'd often read his articles with great interest. He's very articulate when he puts that pen in his hand. He really can roll. And he's written some marvelous articles on the Gottlieb history and some of the aspects of being working for Gottlieb. And for those who saw him today, he did a great presentation, and we just thought it was great for him to come from California to be here. This is his first expo. And John, too, is a designer, and was a designer, worked with Wayne, and designed several games, so we're glad to have him be part of it, too. This is John Osborne. John's like me, he's a collector of sorts, and he's brought several gala memorabilia pieces with him that he'll share with us after the fireside chat. He asked that you look at them and not pick them up because they're very precious to him. But the fireside chat, basically what we'll do is we'll have the mic to all four gentlemen. They'll briefly describe, you know, their recollection of working for the company, and then they'll take questions from the audience. So we'll start with Michael. And maybe for Mike, he'll share what it was like being raised in a wonderful family with such a wonderful name. And we'll go from there.
Hello. Okay, very good. Probably the most distinct memory growing up was that every month there would be a truck that would show up. And this gentleman would open the truck, and he would bring a brand new pinball machine into the house, and he would take the old one away. That was the way things were. That was typical. And then I distinctly remember when D. Gottlieb & Company was sold to Columbia Pictures, because it provided our father the opportunity to spend all of his time with his family, which is what he did for all those years. And then we also distinctly remember when they changed the name to Milestar, which at first was very emotionally painful, but, you know, times change and things change, and the most important thing is, has always been our family. So I think that's, you know, that's kind of my comment right now.
Where to start? Well, we'll start in 1927, real quickly. That was the year D. Gottlieb & Company was incorporated. That was the year I was born. So when you say about being born into a business or an industry, that's exactly what happened to me. All the way back to the time when I was in grade school and we were playing marbles, and I would show up with a couple of big marbles out of the pinball machine. One every time. And from then on, the business was my entire life during all those years. And listening to Steve Cordick reiterate some of the things that he enjoyed about the business, it's the sort of thing that that we all enjoyed about the game business. It was a fun business. We had a lot of nice people to work with, our distributors, our employees, the designers, the engineers, the assembly line people. Everyone throughout the whole plant, the operation was almost a family thing, and we were friends, we were close. And tragedy, God forbid, struck, we were all there to help. And when there were good occasions and the weddings and so forth, we were all there. It was a wonderful experience. And I had the privilege of coming to work in 1947 and being taken into the engineering department by my father and presented to Bob Smith, the chief engineer, said, here, you got him for 2 years, teach him everything. And for 2 years, they worked on me, and particularly this gentleman to my right was sat at the bench next to me and taught me so many things from the ground up, the inception of the games, the construction of the games, the design, the engineering, the electronics, how to build test fixtures, how to lace a cable. And these guys were tough taskmasters, but all in one direction, and it was a very friendly guidance towards learning what makes the business tick. And with that, I want to turn it over to my dear good friend, Wayne Nines.
Oh, thank you, Al. I guess it's on. You know, I came to Gottlieb in 39, 40, and a strange thing at that time, Dave Gottlieb, he was 39 years old. Nate, he was second in command, he was 30 years old. Smith was 24, I was 20. You talk about a young group of guys, unbelievable. Now, I knew Dave in a little different light than anybody else here. And CL, he knew Dave as his father, and I knew him as an employer and a friend. And Dave and I became very close friends. And I can tell you a little incident of what one of the things that brought us so close together. In fact, two things. When I left Western, I was under a little bit of a cloud.
Closer here.
Can everybody hear?
Mike,
closer. A little closer?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Good. If I don't talk loud enough, I just yell, stand up or yell or something, wave your hands. Okay. Anyway, Jimmy Johnson, who owned Western at the time, came over to Dave and told Dave to take that new kid he hired out there and fire him and get rid of him. Well, if you knew Dave Gottlieb, like I knew Dave Gottlieb, no one told Dave Gottlieb to hire or fire or do anything. Dave was his own man. He was a young man and he was a powerful guy. And Dave came out to me, and I was testing playboards at the time, my second day at the company, and he tapped me on the shoulder and he said, "Are you Wayne Nyans?" And I said, "Yes, sir." But I knew it. I knew Dave who he was, but I had never met him, obviously. And he said, "What's the story with you and Jimmy Johnson?" And I said, "Well, we had this and that happen," and I explained the whole story to him. And he listened very carefully, and when he got through, he says, "Wayne, as long as I own this company, you have a job. You never worry about being fired." Well, that was our first introduction. Now, a month goes by or so, not very long, just a very short time. Now I'm 20 years old, remember. I'm a kid. I've had no experience of travel and going around the countryside. Well, we blew the circuitry on a game and made a mistake, and our distributor in New York City,
Mr. Ponzer,
everybody remembers Ponzer, all the old timers surely, had a load of games and he wanted us to fix them. Well, we had nobody to go to New York. You remember this, Al?
I remember George Ponzer.
Yeah, you'll remember this story. So then, anyway, they had no one to go to New York to do this. I'm 20 years old. I'm a kid, just new in the industry to them, as far as Dave was concerned. And anyway, who picked me to be the one to go to New York? I don't know, but I think it was Dave. And I went in the office, and Dave gave me some money. And he said, "You get on that 20th Century tonight and take a box of tools and some parts, and you go to New York and you stay there until you fix these games." Okay. So I'm on the 20th Century, and instead of going in the dining car and buying a dinner, I bought a sandwich and a glass of milk from a vendor going down the aisle. I get to New York the next morning. I get out of the, walk out of Central Station, and I look around the big city, never having been here before. I'm a hayseed right out of Chicago. And I look up and down, and I don't know where the heck I am, and I should have got in a cab and went up to Ponzer's and started work. But I got on the streetcar and drove up and went up Broadway, and I knew when I got around 49th Street or whatever it was, to get off, because that's where Ponzer's was on, 49th Street. I get off the bus and I'm looking for a hotel, and here's a hotel down the street that's called, let me see now if I can remember. I can't remember the name, but it'll come to me in a moment. Anyway, I go into this hotel and I get a room. Well, come to find out, this hotel was about a third-rate hotel, maybe fourth-rate, and it was where all the vaudeville acts stayed. It was the time of vaudeville acts. They had dogs, they had puppies, they had all these animals running around the hallway. It was quite a sight. But anyway, I go over to Ponzer's and I work, and I come back to the hotel, and I go out to supper, and I go over to the automat, and I had supper. And all this time, all these things I'm doing, I'm writing down. Newspaper, 2 cents. Dinner, automat, 18 cents, you know, so forth. Well, to make a long story short, I get back to Dave's office. I go in his office, and I walk up, and I said, "Dave, I'm all done. I finished. I did a good job, and this and that." He said, "Okay." I said, "Here's your money. Here's your list of what I spent." And he don't say nothing. He just looks at me. So I walk out, and a couple of months later, he hadn't said anything to me. A couple of months later, the same thing happens. I go back to see Ponzer again. Well, I go back there. I go into Gottlieb's office, and he hands me a ticket for the train ride, and he handed me a couple hundred dollars. And he said, "Wayne, now I want you to sit down here. I'm going to talk to you." Well, he was a father figure. He taught me something, what life was all about in the big business. And he said, you're working for D. Gottlieb & Company. When you work for Gottlieb, you go first class. When you get on that train, you go in the dining car, and you eat dinner in the dining car. When you get to New York, you get in a cab and ride to the Edison Hotel. The Edison Hotel was a new hotel at that time. Maybe some of you know the Edison. It was a brand new hotel, and it was beautiful. And he says, and you eat dinner in the Edison Hotel, and I want to see the receipt from that. And he says, outside of that, I don't want no receipt. When you travel, Gottlieb, you travel first class. And from then on, he and I were very close friends.
Well, I am the new kid on the block. Here. I didn't start until 1972, post-war. And, of course, Wayne hired me. It was my first job out of college. I came to Chicago from Illinois to take this job. And when I was taken through the factory, what was in the showroom at the time was King Rock and King Koo. Yeah. And as I said, I was 22. And when I started, I realized that everybody had just been there forever, and I thought that was normal, you know, in a big company. Everybody was so old. And it's funny that you said you taught Alvin how to clean switches and how to lace a cable and everything, because he taught me the same thing. The other end, on the other side, see? So, I don't have all these grand old stories. I don't think I ever traveled to the company, except when I went out to fix grab at that time. But it was a great company, and I really had the feeling that I was gonna be there forever. It was a huge place. It took me 2 weeks just to figure out where everything was. It's a big, big company. Lots of rooms, lots of departments. And of course, I found some of the supervisors, you know, a bit on the intimidating side. I mean, again, they'd been there forever, and you know, can I have a step unit gear? You know, and but everybody was, of course, very nice, and it was. What can I say? You know. So, what do you want to do now? We have some
questions from the audience. Dave,
this is probably for Alvin and Wayne. Gottlieb was by far the last company to go with the long flippers, and yet took far less engineering work on your part. You just put a longer bat on the same mechanism, and you instantly got the best flipper action in the industry just by doing that. I'm wondering how much internal debate or agonizing there was over that, about going to a long flipper. Did you think that you didn't want to just be seen as followers, or what was the thinking there?
Well, you know, actually, we had a long flipper long before it ever came out on the market. We had it, never used it. So we had used it in the engineering. In fact, I had made a long flipper, and it was almost the same as, was it Williams that came out with it?
Yeah.
I think it was Williams.
Post time.
Yeah, almost the same. And you know, it's strange that when one person thinks of something, off someplace else, there's someone thinking of the same thing. Why that is, you know, it's hard to understand. It's great minds running the same channel. And I think probably you and I do. But because we designed a lot over many years, and doing the same, building the same type of games.
So did you feel it was taken from you? That
No. I don't say that at all. Just that we had experimented with it, and we knew what the long flipper was, and we enjoyed it. We liked playing it too, but, you know, change, Gottlieb was a, moved very slowly, and firmly, and we were conservative, that's the right word, we were conservative, and we built a quality game that lasted and played. And most of our games, I think Williams' games in general made more money than ours in the first week, first month maybe. But our games had staying power, and I think over the long run, the Gottlieb games worked better and made more money than anybody else's games. And you talk about flippers, you know, talking about when the flipper first came out, when Harry Mabbs made the flipper. Lynn Durant was in the business at that time, building pinball machines too, over at United, and he said he would never put a flipper on a game. Didn't belong on a game, and it didn't take but about 3 or 4 months when he was putting flippers on the game. But the first thing he said was, "I'll never put a flipper on a game."
He's the last one.
Absolutely.
And it wasn't even a plastic flipper, if you remember. It was a metal shoe, and it had two islands and a stretched rubber.
As smart as Lynn Durant was. He missed the boat on that one. Now, Lynn was a smart man.
Absolutely.
And a good businessman. And in fact, the first job I ever had, maybe I probably told it many times before, the first job I had was out of high school. I was still in high school, and it was an afternoon, evening job, was drafting for Western Equipment and Supply Company. My boss was Lynn Durant. He was sitting behind me on a drawing board, and he was my immediate superior. So I knew Lynn when long, long before he ever joined up with Williams as a designer over at Exhibit.
I had two questions. The first, I was wondering if you could comment on the genesis of Backbox animation. It seems like Gottlieb had a lot of mechanical animation in the Backbox in the mid-late 50s and certainly through the 60s. And I have a follow-up question. Essentially, why, how?
Well, one of the very first light box animation that I recall was in a game called Taps. And there was a little mechanical dancer in the light box. And when there were coils, it would pop his feet and cause his legs to flip up and jump around. And if I also remember right, it was like a minstrel show blackface person on there, and that was one of the very first ones. And then there was a long gap between then and then. One of the first animations was the fighting game, the boxer game with the little guys
knockout.
In the middle.
Knockout. That was Knockout. Right. That was Harry Mabsky.
And then later it got into the light box animations, but that was the genesis of it, I think.
Yeah, we put animation in a lot of games, and we didn't like to do it, but it did help the games a little bit, but it was expensive. Some things were terribly expensive, but it was good for the game. We did a lot of it. I think we did more than Williams did. I mean, you didn't do much animation in the light box.
Not to cost too much money.
Too much money. It was a lot of money, and our thought was it better to put it on the playboard than in the animation, but still we did a lot of animation. Some of it was very good. Particularly some of the flipper games, like the flipper cowboy, was it, where the cow or a horse kicked the leg and
buckaroo.
That was, it was entertaining, and it attracted people to the game, and that was good.
Second question, the reason you said you never really liked to do that too much is because it makes the player look up. The player is watching the playfield, he's not watching the light box, and all the action happens while the ball is in play.
Yeah, that's good for management because of the ball drains. Not thinking.
So the question. Yeah, the second question I had, when you were essentially coming out with Polynomic to do a game a month, did you ever feel that you were just sort of throwing something out there, or did you have really enough lead time to come up with another game? It seems like if I look at some of the classics of the 60s, early 60s, mid-60s, you have a lot of the same elements on the playfield, and we just sort of swap from game to game, and it's almost like an assembly line. I'm wondering if there was any of that mentality.
Well, there was a lot of that, really. You notice we went from the four-player, two-player, single-player, add a ball, tad and add a ball, all very similar games. Now, I designed a game that would take maybe 2 or 3 weeks. I was lucky. Sometimes it'd be 4 weeks, but like you say, we make a game a month. Sometimes we made a game every 10 days. And boy, that was a terrible strain. on me, because I was only the designer at the time. And that's why I use a lot of techniques to make one game into the next game. And I used it as a crutch to help myself along. And particularly in add-a-ball games where you take a multiple player game and make an add-a-ball out of it. I could see how you could do that, and I added into it. So that was a very important thing, because I made over 150 games in less than 15 years. So you can see it's almost a game a month.
I have to interject something at this point. Bear in mind that D. Gottlieb & Company factory had many employees, hundreds of them, and there was no such thing as running out of product. All of these people, like I said, our whole atmosphere was one of consideration and care, and we wanted those people to be working continuously. I have to comment that some other manufacturers would simply shut down, send everybody home for a week or two until they had product, and then bring them back again. We never did that. We ran continuously, and it put a heck of a strain on engineering and the design department, but that was the basic concept of doing, using that method of approach.
Over here. Working on the wedge heads, you get a real sense of the quality and the workmanship in the machinery. And obviously, for factory workers, this is probably a difficult thing to maintain. And I'm wondering how you motivated people to maintain that high standard on the production line, because it's quite striking when you work on the old games to see that. You can see it in the machine.
Good supervision, probably. Our general foreman.
Well, it all started in the engineering department, and the comment I have to make on that is that Bob Smith, chief engineer, there was no such thing as a good product with Bob. It was either acceptable or unacceptable. And in combination with Tony Girard, who was primarily a tool and die maker, they had to set quality standards that everything had to work. And that was prevalent throughout the entire shop. We had our own tool and die shop, and Tony ran that originally. And the quality of work out of there was always grade A. Now, I was in the Navy. The factory was in some war production work, and they were making tools and dies for the war effort. They made some forming dies for 50 and 30 caliber machine gun clips, and we were a supplier to Stuart Warner. And of course, those things had to be military spec sort of thing. And that thought pervades throughout the organization where we maintained that degree of quality. And of course, there was always the financial consideration. You can only go just so far in terms of quality control and so forth. And I recall back, distributors would complain sometimes about some games not working all the time continuously around the clock. And my comment was, sure, at that time the games were about $185. I said, sure, if you want to pay $5,000 per game, we can build it to military specs. You're not going to make any money at it. But the quality, if you may recall, Dave Gottlieb came up with the motto, there's no substitute for quality. And he had a little insignia that he used to put on his early wooden pinball machines. And one day I asked him, I said, well, where did that come from, that no substitute for quality? He said, I saw it over a Walgreens store. And I said, what about that little insignia that you had made, the Decalcomania? He said, well, that was from a Cadillac hubcap. True story. But again, it was the quality item that was pervasive throughout the business.
I think also part of that was the fact that, well, certainly when I was there, there was never a time when we weren't testing something. In engineering, we had a separate little room that was no windows and had sound padding on the walls. And we would just, if one of the other engineers, say, came up with a slight change in the flipper, just some little improvement, maybe take a penny out of the cost of it, we'd set up six or seven of these flippers, actually make little baby play fields so they would actually hit a ball, and operate these from the motor, so they would just pulse, constantly, and there'd be a counter on each one. This would go on for a couple of months until we hit maybe a million cycles, just to see how this stuff, nothing went on the games until it was proven. We were always testing relays and decagon units and just anything mechanical. Everything was always subject to improvement.
Yeah, I'm coming to your experience about the concept you came up with called Attaball. That was your baby, wasn't it, Alan?
Oh, well, I'll start with it. Steve Court had made mention of the fact a little bit back about flippers and the legality of games and so forth, and we were in a kind of perpetual semi-state of war with, I would call the gambling-adapted games as against the flipper games, and there would be court cases around the country where some prosecuting attorney would say, oh, these things are gambling devices, and we've got to get rid of them, and all of a sudden the whole territory would go down. In other areas, they'd be running some of the gambling-adapted games, and they'd get wiped out, and it's like the story of throwing the baby out with the bathwater, and the old story about Jimmy Durante laying on the beach, and all of a sudden he's got a bunch of flies on his nose, and one of them bit him, and he says, okay, one wise guy in the crowd, everybody off. The same thing happened with the pins. They were getting knocked out. Well, we had a case up in Hartford, Connecticut, and our distributor up there was in a state of shock because it looks like it was going to go down. And I went up there, it was Mac Perlman, Seaboard, New York. And Mac was very irate and upset and said, well, we're out of business, Al. That's the end of our affiliation with Gottlieb. And I said, Mac, we're going to come up with something. I don't know what it's going to be, but we're going to come up with something that's going to provide a game that will be classified as legal. And I really racked my brain about this thing, and I came up with the idea of, well, the problem with free plays is it was a credit entity that could be reimbursed. That was the genesis of the problem. And I was thinking, well, if we come up with a piece of a free play, you can't do anything with it but play it. And that was the genesis of adding the Attaball idea. And I came back to Chicago and talked with Wayne about it. And he said, well, there could be something there, but I don't think your dad's going to go for that. And that was one of my biggest sales projects, was getting a hold of my dad and trying to convince him that this thing has merit. And finally, I think just to get rid of me, he said, well, okay, let's go in and talk to Wayne. And then that was the end of the story for me, and the rest of it follows to Wayne.
Now, Dave came in and mentioned the same thing, you know, we got to do something to help out these locations. And so, I don't know, the Attaball just came to me, and I put one together, and once we got it together and started playing it, man, we liked that game, and we never could quite understand why, on location, an Attaball game would not make money if they could have on a free play game. And in our showroom, we have an Attaball game alongside of a four-player, two-player, and a single-player game, and we go in to play at night, and evening to play, and we all gravitate to the Attaball games. We like to play Attaballs, and I know I still like to play Attaball games, but once we saved a lot of territory, Texas I think was one, Wisconsin, New York, there was a lot of them, and it kept them alive until they could change the laws. But you know, when the pin games, they were pinball machines, really what they were. They were gambling devices with knockoff buttons. You all know what a knockoff button is. And I can tell you a little story about a knockoff button. It's kind of interesting. One day, I get a call from the switchboard that somebody up in the front door wants to see me. And so I go up there, and here's a guy from the Justice Department. He hands me a subpoena. And he says, you're to be in Scranton, Pennsylvania next Monday, whatever it was. You're going to testify in a case on a game that's been picked up. So, man, I talked to Dave right away, and Dave said, well, okay, we'll send our lawyer with you, Rufus King, your old buddy. And so Rufus and I show up in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and I get there on a Sunday night, and this case is coming up on a Monday. And I don't want to get to the hotel when someone knocks on the door and here's a guy from the Justice Department. And you got to come over here and you got to help us. We're in serious trouble. And I go over to the to this office on Sunday night, and here these lawyers are all sitting around there. They're going to trial the next morning. And I said, well, you got to tell us. We can't make this game knock off. You can't knock off free plays. And, it don't work. And, how can I have a case? I can't prove this thing. So we looked at the playboard and took a look at it. And here, you know, there are many ways to operate the knockoff button. Sometimes you just push the switch up every time you wanted it. Sometimes you tap the bottom. Sometimes the button protruding. And all these different ways that we're trying. But this guy, this operator, he took the wires off the switch and he ran them, soldered new wires on. He ran them out the back of the cabinet, threw a hole in the floor, down through the floor of this tavern, underneath, up the other side, in, to the bar. Now, the player would win his free plays, and he'd go to the bartender, hey, give me my 50 cents or whatever, and he'd push the button under the bar, and mysteriously, they were wiped off. Anyway, they raided the place, they grabbed the machine out the front door with the machine. Now they got it up in the office, and they're going to take it to court the next day. They can't make it knock off because the wires are pulled out. So as soon as I see it, I went, you know, this is what this problem is. So anyway, the next morning, I'm talking to Rufus King, and Rufus' wife was with us. She came, and she was a very sick woman at the time. She was quite ill. But she came along with him, and we were sitting in the court, and these lawyers are going through their usual routine. And so Rufus says to me, Wayne, if you can get that crabby old judge to come down and stick his head inside of that machine, I'm going to buy you a bottle of liquor. And I said, Rufus, you got a deal. And so anyway, finally came to my time to get on the stand, and I get up there, and I'm sitting on the stand, and these lawyers, they don't know what they're talking about. And the judge looks up. He was the crabbiest old looking judge I had ever seen in my life. No smile, no nothing. And finally came the time I had to make my move. And so I turned around to the judge and said, Your Honor, if you come down here, and I think I could show you what's going on. He gets up off that bench, comes down, and he sticks his head in one side of the machine. The playboard is sticking up in the air, you know, on his board. And I stick my head in the other side, and he tells me, what the hell is going on here? He said, you know, I've got a rule on this case, and I don't know what you're talking about. And I said, well, let me show you what this is. And so I pointed out the knockoff switch where the wires were taken off, where the wires were soldered on, where the holes were out the back. And he says, okay. He says, I got it. He was just like a father figure. He was just as nice a man as you would ever want to meet anywhere. He was a gentleman of the first class, you know, and of course, I was scared of him. I was only still a young guy. Anyway, he goes back and gets on the bench, and I go sit back in the seat, the witness chair, and I look out in the audience, and Rufus's wife is gone. I don't think much more of it because, you know, she's been ill, and she's not feeling very well. And so I look, and pretty soon the door opens up, and in walks this woman carrying a paper bag with a bottle of liquor, you know, and I can't help but smile. To make a long story short, we won the case, and I had the bottle of liquor, and that was one of my experiences with a knockoff button.
I've got to make mention of a very important point. There was always a lot of controversy amongst the manufacturers about that knockoff button. And over the years, it became a symbol of a gambling device. And at that time, way back when, there was a business association called the Coin Machine Institute. And my father and Harry Williams and several of the other guys belonged to it. And there was always a controversy about that button. And one day, Harry Williams called up Dad and said, this is it, I am taking the button off my game. I don't care what you do. And my dad says, well, Harry, I have to agree with you. He said, you're making the first move, I'll follow. And that was the end of the knockoff button on the bottom of the amusement type games. Harry was the one that took the lead on that. And, you know, I have to make mention of Harry because he was a very good friend of my father's, and I knew him. I wasn't old enough to know him very well, but you've heard his name many, many times.
one of the founders of the industry, one of the great innovators, and a real wonderful guy, and a guy who flew his own Beechcraft all over the country. I envied him for that.
When was that? 1951.
That was our last game with a knockout.
That, for some reason, there's this incredible mystery about Leroy Parker, because he did all these games and he seems like he was a ghost. Like, no one knows what he looks like. He seemed to work in such privacy that no one has any stories about him. What is the case with Leroy Parker?
Well, there's a lot of stories about Leroy. He was very quiet, I'm assuming. Tremendous character, not a character, a tremendous gentleman. He was about as nice a man as you ever wanted to know, and nothing riled him. And you know, an artist, and he was an artist, a good artist, he was about the best. And you know, a good artist don't like to be told how to make changes. You don't take criticism very easily. Parker was not that way at all. You could criticize his artwork, you could criticize the shape, the legs were too long, or the busts were too big, or too small, or too this, or too that. And he never got angry at us. And he took it as we meant it. And so many times, he would come over to our place late afternoon, and generally late afternoon, and we would tell him what we liked and what we didn't like. And sometimes we'd tell him, we don't like anything you got there. And he would go home, and he had a studio at his home, and he would redraw, make changes or whatever, and be back waiting at the door in the morning when we came to work. That's the kind of man he was, a conscientious and a tremendous artist, and never got riled at any time that I ever remember.
I have to back that up. I used to use my desk there in Tony's office to spread the work out. And it was usually my dad would come in and take a look at it. And my dad was very opinionated about what he liked and what he didn't like. And he was very fond of Leroy Parker. He was just devoted to his style and his work. And when he would tell Leroy to do something semi-comical, Leroy would come back with it and my dad would slap his head and say, boy, that's exactly what I wanted. And if he wanted to change it, like Wayne was saying, there was never a question. Leroy was happy to do it, and they're so quiet and unassuming. Like you say, he didn't appear to be like, you know, a bombastic type at all, as some artists are.
How come there's no pictures of him?
No pictures. So somebody,
Larry Buzz?
Yeah, has a picture of him. And he's supposed to send me a picture. He's going to. Supposedly he found his son, who lives in Arkansas, not too far from where I'm at. I'm going to try and get in touch with him, because it's only maybe 100 miles away.
I just wanted you guys to smile, that's all. There she comes, just a walking through the crowd.
$25. Somebody can use this.
That has many things on the map of the playfields that we think we may be able to identify as a real good. And we'll start and on.
During the last two decades, as a five-time world champion, Rick Steada has set standards of excellence that all future champions must aspire to match. The positive recognition he has brought the pinball hobby has helped it grow in the direction of becoming a professional sport. So that's for Rick. Thank you, Matt. And there's a player of the year. Maybe this is the most coveted one of all, the player of the year. For 1999, the player of the year was to Trent Augenstein. Probably is Trent here anyway? He's out practicing. Okay. So an award for winning three major competitions in 1999. So Trent won three competitions. And as I did a review with the different players over the internet, I kept getting the names of different competitions they thought he won. And I think we actually have one of them incorrect on listed here. But he either won Pinburg 99, the Ohio State Pinball Championship, the Michigan State Championship, some contest in Ann Arbor, and something else. We don't scrape, we're not sure which three. We'll figure it out, maybe send it the right one through the mail if he doesn't come to get this. Okay? I have two final awards. And now these awards are very significant because sometimes it's even more important than just being a player to keep everything going right, everything working, everything flourishing, everything becoming nourished. Some people deserve awards for the heart they have, the energy they have, the attention they have, the love they give, all the different kinds of things that they do to make our hobby grow and prosper and become better.
No problem.
So here's an award given on behalf of all of us. And the award has a big red headline at the top of it. And the award says, "The industry thanks Walt Burke." The industry thanks Walt Burke. And it says, "An award for bringing the pinball industry to life." And as a co-organizer of the Pinball Expo 99, a premier event promoting the legacy of pinball, Rod Burke has inspired the world to see the cultural significance and the historical importance of the pinball industry, and through his selfless and generous efforts has helped generate a modern golden age of pinball playing for all to enjoy. Let's hear it for Rod. And that's Mike Pasak edition of the same award. And so thank you very much. I just have one last thing. Bob wants the mic, but I can't have it. Okay, the last thing I want to tell you is you might have saw this poster hanging up. Billy Mitchell, that Pac-Man player, happens to have a company that sells hot sauce, and they put up some cash bounties on high scores for video games. He's been paying $1,000 per hit for different old classic video game high scores to be broken. One Canadian's already got two $1,000 checks for breaking the high score, and Dig Dug the high score on Tutong Khan, which is made by Stern. Okay, he's very interested in doing something similar for pinball. I'm very open to hearing any advice or recommendations from any of the star players, or anybody who thinks that they know what would be a very appropriate watershed benchmark score on a game that he should put a bounty up to inspire people to go for more and more records. So you'll have no trouble finding me because I'm at the Twin Galaxy scoreboard, and this poster will be out on the table anyway. I promise you can take copies. Now the last thing I'm going to do is I have two copies of the book. Simple contest. The first person to shout the answer gets the door. Okay, ready?
42.
Okay, who wrote the famous book by Herman Melville? And what was the author's name?
Moby Dick?
What's Rob Burke's last name?
Burke!
Come on. Okay, thank you very much.
I'd like to see a replay.
Hey, that's in 3 days, I guess. I can tell you I'm glad I'm here. Do you remember the seminar about the WPC repair? It was from Clay Harrell and Rob Hayes. He told us that Williams changed to the European fuses, the small ones instead of the American big ones. And about 3 weeks ago, I was together with a guy, and he had a whirlwind, and he asked me, "Jurgen, do you know a place where we can buy these U.S. fuses, the big ones?" And I told him, "Well, it's difficult, but I know some places." And he said, "Well, I had 3 ones broken, and just to be sure, I wrapped them all in tin paper. So if Williams comes to your home with this small European fuses, don't try this at home." If Robert talks about the fire, this is the fire in a pinball machine, so don't worry about it. All right. I'd like to thank all the people who organized
people tonight. He's the designer of such wonderful games as Addams Family, Funhouse, you name it, goes on and on and on. All wonderful games, fun games, and we're glad his family is here tonight to see him with his presentation. Please welcome Pat Lawler.
Okay, and he looks over and he says, "Bad company."
show doing at dinner. This isn't us, okay? A Pete Waller show on a good day upsets your stomach. Right? Think about it, you know, like the food won't upset your stomach here tonight, okay? But the Pete Waller show is just not good for that. I want to see a show, I want to see a quick show of hands. How many people had the beef? Huh? The beef? Uh-oh. How many people had the fish? Yeah? Okay. You guys ever see that movie where everyone's on the airplane? And like you know, the pilot had the beef? Okay? And then, like, someone's got to fly the plane because something bad happened? Okay? You'll notice I didn't eat dinner? Okay? The reason for that is when this baby goes down in flames, I still need to be up here.
Oh, no.
Tradition at this banquet is about the dinner speaker getting up here and talking about their personal life. They talk about when they were little, and they talk about, you know, how they grew up, and then they show some slides of their motorcycles. I can't do that, okay, for a couple of reasons. First of all, you all expected to see a great show, and we're going to give you that, we hope. Secondly, I'm honored to be up here because I've been sat where you are, and I've been thrilled watching people like Mr. Gottlieb and Mr. Kordek and Mr. Ritchie, okay? And no matter what I've done in this business, it's dwarfed by what those people have done in the business, okay? But I did feel it necessary to give you a small glimpse into my past. So last weekend, for whatever reason, my sisters dug this up at my parents' house. This is a copy, it's not a copy, it is the report card from the Chicago Public Schools from kindergarten for Pat Long. And I'd just like to share this with you because I think it's great. It says, Patrick is a strange little person who really needs to learn to color between the lines. This woman was prophetic. I spent a career not coloring between the lines. And I think that's that speaks volumes. D. I don't know about you guys. How many people are staying here in the hotel? Are there show of hands? Oh my God. How many people are staying in the tower? Okay? Yeah, hey, it's a wall, huh? I'm a real easy guy to get along with, okay? I'm really laid back and you know, stuff just doesn't bother me most of the time. And I got here the other at night, and so I went and got my, you know, my room key and stuff, and I came over to the elevators here, and then I checked my watch, and you know, 10 minutes later the elevator appeared, and I went upstairs to my room, and I walked in. I needed to make a couple of phone calls, and I punch in the numbers on the phone, you know, beep 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 beep. And it goes beep 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 like that. You know? So I can't use the phone. The phone doesn't work. And I can't call the desk because the phone doesn't work. So I walk back down to the fastest elevators on the planet over here. Okay? And I wait and I ride the elevator down and I go up to the desk and I wait nicely in line for you know for one thing. And I get this the woman behind the desk and I say, you know, excuse me, you know, my phone doesn't work. And she said, oh, what's your name? You know, I give my name. And so she picks up the phone and she says something very quickly into the phone, like, you need to reset 2732. Okay, so I said, you know, she said, you know, why don't, she says, why don't you try it now? I said, well, I'm not near the phone now. I said, it's a long way back up on your elevator system, and I'd really like to know. She says, I think it'll work. So I get back, I go back to the elevator bay, and these elevators, you know, give new meaning, okay, to the term leisure travel. So I get back up to my room, and I walk in, and I punch in a number, you know, beep, 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 and it goes, beep, beep, beep. Okay, so now I got to make a phone call, okay? I really need to make a phone call. I wanted to call home and do a few other things. So I come back down the elevator, and as I'm walking back up to the main desk, they've got this giant line of people there now, okay? And I'm like, okay, I'm not going to wait in line for this. And as I'm walking by, the woman behind the desk goes like this. She goes, like, you know, she fixed it, but she didn't. And I'm not going to wait in line. And so I went out to my truck, and I got my cell phone, and I called the front desk. I said, my phone doesn't work. And she said, how are you calling us? So they finally fixed the phone. I come back in, I get back on the elevator from the beyond. I get up to my room and I decide, okay, I've made my phone call, I gotta take a shower. And I gotta stop for a minute because I'm a real, these guys, everybody who works with me knows that I'm a suspicious person. They're all gonna laugh, they all know this. There are things happening everywhere around me. You know, the X-Files is nothing compared to
you can have it.
So there's this, I decided that, right, this hotel chain has this guy named Bob. Okay, and like, you know, I don't know what his real name is, but he's an executive somewhere, okay? And he's in charge. He starts out right, he's got this little office, and they put him in charge of saving money. And so he decided that, you know, like, if you couldn't call out, you know, that, you'd be forced to be riding his elevators, which are slow because he's saving electricity, and maybe you'll take the stairs and all like that, you know. So this guy's sitting there, he's thinking of ways he's going to save money for the chain. And so I'm thinking about this, you know. And I get back to the room and I decide to take a shower. I get in the shower and I notice, and you'll all agree, you're staying in here. Why doesn't the shower curtain reach the top? Okay? Why? How is he supposed to take a shower without getting water all over the floor? If the shower curtain is... This guy found a carload of shower curtains, okay? And he bought them, he put them in, and now, because he saved this much money, they're making them like he's in charge of some committee somewhere, okay? Well, the final insult was, I walked over to get a thing of Kleenex, and you know how they got that nice little point on the Kleenex, you know, that they do and everything? I pulled the Kleenex out, it's the only one in there. I figured that's one thing made this guy a vice president. Okay. One other thank you, and we're going to get rolling here on the Pat Wallace Show. I would like everybody in this room, if you could find it in your heart, to thank the guys who did the tournament system. They did it on their own time from Williams. That tournament system is a tribute to what engineers can do with almost nothing and on their own
time at all.
To make those games out there live on the internet the way they do and talk to the mother thing. I think you guys deserve it. Friends at the bar.
Did everyone get a coffee?
Okay. I also want to thank George Gomez for yesterday. George, from the bottom of his heart, did a presentation that blew me away. And I think it was awesome, George, and I mean that. About Pin 2000, I'm going to tell you my one Pin 2000 story that I think is the best story ever. And I'm going to drag everybody up here to do this thing. This is a true story. This is a true story. A year ago, we were in Las Vegas and George was doing Monster Bash. Okay, they were in Las Vegas to show Monster Bash. And we needed to get to an awards dinner, and we were at the... Even Lyman loves this story. We needed to get to an awards dinner, and so we're at the Mirage, and we get a cab. And we hop in the cab, and there's myself, there's George Gomez, there's Lyman Sheets, and there's Steve Kordak. And we jump in the cab, and the cab driver starts to make idle chat. He says, "Hi, what do you guys do for a living?" And we're like, "Yeah, we make pinball machines." And the cab driver, without missing a beat, this is the truth, they will tell you, okay, turns around in the middle of traffic, points at us, and says, "You know, if pinball machines had holograms in them that you could hit with the ball and make explode, people would play pinball again." That's a true story. Okay, this is long before we showed Kim 2000 to anyone. Okay? So George has decided that this cab driver, if you could just find him again, knows how to set up world peace, cure cancer. He's driving around Las Vegas, he knows it all. It was weird. All we talked about the rest of the trip was the weird cab driver that knew how to fix our system. Okay, let's play the Pat Lawler Show. Let's rock and roll. I need to get all you guys up here to be part of the Pat Lawler Show. This is going to be kind of a logistical nightmare. We're going to do the best we can. We are going to try and play Hollywood Squares. And what we're going to do is, I'm going to try and explain the rules to you while my cohorts are setting up the area. We're going to divide the room exactly in half. Okay, so there's track that's above us, okay? Everybody that's on that side of the room is O's. You guys are the O's. You guys are the X's. And when your side wins, we have all this cool stuff that we swept out of our offices. That we'll find on eBay on Monday. Rare Pat Lawler floor sweeping, autographed by him, $5,000. Anyway, we're going to give away all that stuff, okay? We've got a lot of stuff to try and give away tonight. And I'm going to be roaming around in the audience talking to you. We've got questions that we're going to be asking these guys. They're prepared questions. You're going to have to decide if the person that's answering the question is telling the truth or not. It's Hollywood Squares. Now, they could be lying through their teeth. Okay, in which case you have to say, "I think he's lying." And, you know, and then we'll let you know. And if when you're right, you get a prize. If your side wins the game, we're going to pick like 10 numbers or 15 numbers. You know those little chips that are on your table, okay, that have a number on them? That's how we're going to decide is getting stuff and is answering the questions. So, without further ado, if you'll just give us about 4 seconds to get this act together here, we'll be ready to go on the Pat Lawler Show. So take a quick, deep breath, and we're going to do this thing. Attack from Mars, chips with a number. Does everybody have one except for the people who didn't pay for dinner? In other words, I don't mind you're here for the Pale Dollar Show. It's just that the people who paid for dinner have a right to like play the game. So,
number, please raise your hand. Does anyone not have a number?
Okay,
Brad. Exactly. All right, I see one hand. I'll be right there.
Okay.
Just like that guy on the far right, is he the guy who did Cactus Canyon?
I don't know.
Cotton would go good with that cake.
Oh.
Okay.
Keep
scaring
me. Very quickly going to ask the gentlemen that are the illustrious Hollywood Squares, actually, about some of what they've done and all of that. I know it's a little hard to see out on the edges. We'll do the best we can to help you out with what's going on, okay? I know it's tough. We kind of did this on the fly. So without further ado, we're going to start out with
is anyone sitting there?
The bottom row of the Hollywood Squares. Just everybody, tell everybody who you are. Give a quick description of what you do in rock and roll.
I'm Greg Ferris. I do artwork, and I did like Revenge from Mars, Scared Stiff, Harlem Globetrotters, Fat in the Hole, those kind of good things.
I'm John Yelsey. I'm an artist, and I've done all the past games. I'm not going to mention them with the exception of the first two.
Steve Cornett. And John King Pinball.
I'm Ted Estes. I've done a few of Pat's games for software.
Roger Sharp, trapped in the middle again. Scott Polianni. Scott Polianni, I've done Dot Matrix work since Adam's Family, and I've did some 3D graphics for the Star Wars game and Revenge from Mars. Duncan Brown, programmer, I did some of the software in Star Wars.
Lyman Sheets, I'm a programmer, and I work for George.
He just wants you to feel sorry for him. I'm George Gomez. I'm a game designer, Corvette, Giant Mnemonic, LA, Fast Break, Monster Bash, and Revenge from Mars.
And I want you to know I took George out last night and bought him a couple of beers. He's feeling a little better today.
A couple!
Howdy,
okay, Mr. Patler, if you would please pick an X, which is over there, a number. Okay, we need a number?
397.
Who's got chip 397? Anyone? 397 over on this side of the room? No? Pick another one. Same box. 315? 315. Okay, we have our first sucker, contestant. Okay, you get to choose one of the happy pinball squares here. He's going to go for the man in the middle. Right away he's going for the cat. Whoopee! Okay, we've got a question for Roger. Roger, if you had your choice of either playing pinball or golf, which one would you choose?
God, that's tough. At least you didn't say which do I play better at. Let's go with golf.
Golf? Can it be that the illustrious Mr. Roger Sharp would
in a hostile environment to actually say
would that. Rather play golf than pinball? Do you believe him or not?
Well, I don't know. We see pinball is it. I guess we say pinball.
You're gonna say pinball? What do all the X's think? I think you're in big trouble. What's the right answer?
Golf.
They get a no. Okay, we need a chip for over that side of the room, please, Mr. Patel.
88.
There we go. Okay, Mr. 88, we're on the move. This is cool. I'm going to lose 5 pounds doing this. Okay, which one of the lovely contestants would you like to? I know it's hard to see over here, so you can. Roger's in the middle. Okay.
Ted.
Hi, we're having a technical difficulty here. We're trying to figure out which questions are for Ted. Okay, there we go. We've got one. I'm sorry. I apologize.
Saw him peeking. Ted, was a thin flips feature ever considered for Twilight Zone?
Let's see, that was a while ago. I'm trying to remember. As I recall, Pat, you didn't have that really in mind, but we thought maybe it would be kind of cool to put in. And I think I spent some time working on it, but gave up on it because it wouldn't fit into the code.
Okay. Do you believe him? I know you've got on an Our Leader Ted shirt here. Okay. And since he's praise be ye, and since he's your leader, you should always believe him, right?
Of course, he can rely.
So you believe what he just said?
Yes.
Ted?
Yes, that's true.
We've got two O's. It looks like Scott Slomianni is in the hot seat here. What do you need, Mr. Pat?
135.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Wow, I blew part of the show here. If you blow it, you don't get a prize, but the person who got the prize gets a prize. So over in the corner, we're giving them a lovely bottom arch and a button and a t-shirt. Excellent. Okay, Mr. Pat.
135.
Got 135 for the X's? Right there? Okay. It looks like you'd want Scott Slomianni to block. Howdy. You having a good time? Okay, don't get nervous. Okay, we have a question, okay?
Would this be for me?
This is for Scott. Okay. What was the original theme for the No Fear video mode?
If I remember correctly, Steve wanted to do a NASCAR racing video mode with all the other goofy stuff, with all the extreme sports in there, but because it was a separate license, we really couldn't do it, and we couldn't afford two licenses for one game.
Is he telling the truth or not telling the truth? He's telling the truth? Okay.
You better be
truth.
Truth? Truth? What do the rest of the X's think? Yeah? No? Everyone's unsure. I don't think you're allowed to win on a default. They have to win on a run. So what's the right answer?
The answer is false.
Yeah.
The story basically went that me and Matt Correal at the time were going, well, the game needs a video mode, we got an idea, let's do a water ski jumping game. And so we were just kind of working that on our own, and then Steve and his mighty wisdom, as always, came into the office on what we were doing, and basically went, Farr, what are you doing? It's got to be a dirt bike game! And at that point, it became a dirt bike video mode.
Okay, you guys have to win on your own, and the number is?
2-2-2.
2-2-2. Who's got 2-2-2? Right there, okay. Is it going to be Scott? Is it going to be Scott? Yeah, you're going for Scott for the win.
Scott to win.
Scott to win. Okay. Let's take a quick look. And we have... How many 3D models given to us by Lucasfilm can actually be seen in the Star Wars Episode I pinball machine?
As I was on stage a couple days ago, Lucas did give us a lot of stuff to work with, made things easier, and a lot of it was the models. I want to say there was probably about 7 models that we used directly from their resources.
Do you believe him or not?
Yes.
He believes him. What's the right answer, Scott?
That would be false.
Yeah.
like nobody wants the victory. Okay, Mr. Pavlo, what number do we have for the
excellent? Just for clarification, basically there's nothing in all the models were basically purposely screwed up by Lucas so we couldn't use them and we had to use them for reference. So all the models in the game were basically hand-built by the 3D department, just using their stuff as reference.
All seven of them.
Yep, so they got the, they get the block. They've got the block with the X, okay? So, what's our next number?
192.
192. 192, ah, all the way back to the room. Okay, here we go. Okay, who would you like?
Line and Sheets.
Line and Sheets. Top center.
Hello.
Okay, Lyman, here's your question. Is it true that the material used to mold the trolls in Medieval Madness was old, unused, melted down Bluto heads? From Papa. Is that true?
I think so. I think we might have had a few of them.
Do you believe that we melted down Bluto heads to make trolls? No? What's the right?
No.
No. All right, they get an X. Okay. We're just zooming up here. Okay, Mr. Pavlo, we need a number for the O's.
We have a nice
prize. I'm sorry, we need a prize. A t-shirt and, ooh, nice pictures. I'm sorry. I'm moving as fast as I possibly can. There you go. Thank you very much for playing the game. All right, Mr. Pavlo, what's the number? 41. 41. Who's got 41? 41. 41. Going once. Going twice. I see people with a felt-tip marker out. That's not fair. Over there? Back there? Okay, we're in the back. We got in the back. Who would you like? Steve Kordak, okay. Okay. Steve.
Yes, sir.
Gottlieb produced the first flipper game in October of 1947. In early 1948, how many other companies made games with flippers?
So many, I can't remember. But I'll say 10.
10. Now, I know this guy's got a memory that'll just bury everyone here, okay? So do you believe 10?
I disagree.
You're absolutely right, because it was 8.
Uh-oh, it looks like the X's are on the move here. Okay, so we have an O, O, O. So it could either be Duncan or it could be George, right? Okay. So what's our number? Oh, prize. We have to do a prize. Game prize, we're set. Okay.
299.
299. Well, 299 in the corner? Back here? No? It's not you? 299? 299? 299? Going once, going twice. Nope.
52.
52. There he is. Who would you like to choose?
George.
They're going for the block here, right? The block. Yeah, it's the block. But if they get the block, they've got Duncan for the win, maybe. Okay.
I want you to know, I asked these guys to like give me these questions a few weeks ago, and they walked. Some of them walked up to me today with napkins. Okay. How many different girls are in the Catch Me game in Corvette?
There are six. You know, the French girl, the German girl, the Italian girl, Spanish girl, the British girl, and the American girl.
What do you think? Is he telling the truth or is he lying?
I think he's lying.
You think he's lying? Oh. What's the answer, George?
That is correct. I'm lying.
Okay.
I wanted that many, but I only got four.
Do we have a prize?
X.
You gotta hold up the right thing. We're getting a prize. Prize. Who's got the prize?
Hey, Duncan, are you ready?
Sure.
183.
183. All right. Excellent. 183. Looks like Duncan's on the hot seat. What are we going for? Are you going to go for Duncan?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. We've got a question for Duncan. Duncan. Hi. How are you doing?
Good.
Okay. What device first appeared on the Steve Kordek-designed Vagabond pinball machine?
I believe that was a disappearing bumper.
A disappearing bumper. Do you believe it?
No.
You don't believe him? You think he's lying? I like Duncan. He wouldn't lie to you. He's lying. What's the answer?
A cock target.
Yeah! Well, there's still the possibility of a win here. Oh, so we got a diagonal. The O's win.
Absolutely unbelievable to look at this list of names and somehow be associated or put in the same league. So I thank everyone for that honor. This being the 15th year of Expo, it really was appropriate for Rob and Mike to get some recognition and praise. I grew up being a total pinball fanatic. And I played all the games. I was into pinball more than anything else. I watched for every new game to come out. And I just really loved it, but I had very few people to share that with. Because in that time there was no internet and there were no pinball conventions. And by having the Expo and all the other events that all the hard workers have put together, it's given me and everyone here a way to make many new friends. And I really also cherish all those pinball relationships. And for those of you that have seen some of these shows come and go, it really gives you a perspective of how much work and how big an effort, how hard it is to do this year after year after year. So big hand for Rob and for Mike for doing all of this. Because it really has created this community, and it's really something that we should all treasure. Thank you.
You've had a fantastic. Thank you, Nick.
Thanks a lot. I'm going to eat this later.
Ball machines.
First off, I'd like to thank everybody that helped me out. Mr. Hopper flew in all the way from Portland, Oregon. I'd like to thank Brad and Kelly from Skyven Amusement, who donated not one, but two of the pinball machines you're going to win tonight. I'd like to thank all the suppliers that gave us stuff. Williams gave us a bunch of prizes. The Pin Game Journal gave us a bunch of subscriptions. All the other people that threw stuff in, thanks a bunch. We raised $5,030. Very worthwhile charity. Before we do the drawing, I'd just like to encourage everybody in the room tonight, when you go home, think about starting your own local pinball collectors club. This is me and Mr. Hopper and some people from Las Vegas have done this. We've had a lot of fun with it. We've raised a lot of money for charity. The factories are trying to support pinball at the top end. I think it's time for the collectors to get together on the bottom end, form local clubs. Maybe pushing a little bit of the demand on the bottom will help the factories, and pinball won't disappear and die. We have a volunteer here, a youngin. What's your name?
Justin.
Justin is going to be our drawer. We're spinning it around and around and around. We're going to draw three items. The first item is going to be the Atlantis pinball machine. I'm going to ask him to reach in here and draw one ticket. This will be for a Valley Atlantis pinball machine. You saw it on the floor. We have a number 320.
Oh, no.
320 translates to the winner of the Atlantis pinball machine.
Is that us?
320. Kelly and Brad won their machine back.
We can't accept it, no!
They respectfully pass on their own machine. It is a strange game.
They donated the machine.
What are the odds on that?
Really?
Well, I feel lucky tonight.
3-2-0.
Oh.
Okay, we're going to draw another one. This is for the Atlantis pinball machine. I hope it's not number 320. We have 327.
Both.
Both sides. Both sides.
Brad Sagarin from North Aurora, Illinois.